Hello friends, in the last class we were discussing T.S. Eliot's essay, Tradition and the Individual Talents. Now the first part I have already done, I have defined what tradition is according to T.S. Eliot and also how tradition impacts an author's work. Now once again I will just do a recap of what we did in the last class, that is I said it is all about relationship. The essay is about relationship. And the whole essay, as I told you, can be summed up in just one word, and that is relationship. And what kind of relationship? Relationship to whom? The first relationship is to tradition. The author's relationship to tradition. And the second is his own work, his own work, or the poet's relationship to his poem. Now tradition, as we have seen, has got many synonymous expressions in the essay itself. We have already seen that. Once again I will write. First one is tradition itself, second one is, what is the second one? The literary world, up to and including literary world, up to and including the present. The past literary world and the present, up to this point, that is tradition. Or you can say, another expression is the mind of Europe. The mind of Europe. That is also, in a way it is very abstract. When I say mind of Europe, what do you mean by that? Mind of Europe. So that is, the concrete expression of that is literary world up to, or an existing order, you can say. The existing order of, existing order of literature. Existing order of literature, you can say, that is further. Or again, you can say the fifth one. See, I have taken this not from anywhere else. I have taken this from the essay itself. And the sixth one, you can say, it is other poems by other writers. Other poem means work of art, poems by other writers. Other poems by other writers, isn't it? Now sixth, you can say, tradition, that means literature from Homer to the present. Homer to the present. Or you can say it is a simultaneous order. Simultaneous order. Simultaneous, that is order. Or eighth one you can say, that is the timeless and the temporary. Timeless. Timeless and the temporary. These are expressions from the essay itself. Timeless and the temporary. The definition, you know, the historical sense, which is the sense of the timeless and the temporary, and the timeless and the temporary together is what makes a writer historical. Yes. And ninth you can say, the past tense, plus present and present continuous. Present continuous. That is tradition, you can say. Past tense and present continuous. And tenth expression, you can say, pastness of the past. Pastness of the past. Now these are different expressions. Similar expressions used in the essay by T.S. Eliot himself to tell us what he meant by tradition. So that therefore he says tradition is not something that is not old-fashioned. Tradition is not copying the ancient authors. Tradition is not plagiarism. Tradition is not a preference for a period. Tradition is not any preference for a particular author. tradition is not any preference for a particular form of literature, none of these things. Because it is, as we have seen, an existing order. And the relationship between tradition, the existing order of literature, and the new one is, we have seen, the past is altered by the present, just as the present is directed by the past. That is the thing. So two key words there. One is present can alter the past. That the existing order can be changed by the present work, provided it is a great one. And who will decide which is great or which is not great? That is decided by the immense concentration, whether the work of art has whether the work of art has in it the immense concentration of the poet, the synthesizing, under the immense concentration, synthesizing of regular or irregular, irrelevant or incongruous elements, unrelated elements. There has been artistic process through which all these things have been incorporated, or you can say synthesized. See, so that is immense concentration. Then that has to be, there should be a synthesis. The artist's mind becomes a smithy. Understand? And then what happens is, if you have this criteria, naturally what will happen? You will enter into the existing order. Existing order you can change, you can demand entrance, and it will change. Then what will happen? That will be included in tradition for the next writer. That is the thing. So the existing order you can change by the present writer. Then the present and the past becomes a new tradition. And this new tradition will direct the next writer. So it is dynamic, always changing. Understand that? Change is the only thing that will not change. That means there will always be change. It is dynamic. Tradition is dynamic. The sense, as I have already told you yesterday, that is, historical facts will not give you historical sense. That is why, you know, Eliot himself says that, you know, if you go to British Museum and you can go on studying British history, but you may not get the historical sense. And here is another person, just by reading Plutarch, that is Shakespeare, he got immense historical sense. So that is a different thing. You see that? So I hope you understand pastness of the past, very abstract, mind of Europe, very abstract. But there are other things like that. Literature, a simple language, we can say, all the literature written by other authors up to and including the present moment when you write. Then if that is incorporated or admitted in the tradition, that becomes a new tradition, because the present has influenced or altered the past. But at the same time, remember, past has the power to direct the present. I think now that is very clear to you, isn't it? I have given you examples of uniform, school uniform. I gave you examples of Muslims, like then what happened when Taj Mahal entered into the arena, the existing order changed. This change of existing order happens not only in literature, but in all the human experiences or areas where human beings act and react. Understand? See, your dress, for example, the dress that you are wearing, think of the tradition, that is years of order, and that order now slowly changing when you put on a jeans and a t-shirt. Look at that. So that is how the change, and then that becomes the order, the new order. Existing order becomes a new order, and that becomes tradition for the next writer, for the next person who does something new, worthwhile. That is very important. So I hope now I am very clear. Yesterday, you can also refer to my lecture, my first lecture, definition of tradition. All these things I already told you. Now this next relationship, I told you, whose relationship? That is poet's relationship. One to tradition. Then second is his own work. That's the thing. His own work. Now, what happens to his own work? When the past directs the present, what does the tradition do to an author? He is disciplined. There are some restrictions. You cannot do whatever you want and say that this is literature. You cannot do that. Eccentricity is ruled out. Extreme, strange uniqueness is ruled out. Because there is a disciplining factor. Or you can say a restricting factor. Restrict. That is, tradition restricts the author's, the literary activity. Not his potential, but the literary activity. Because we have already seen tradition, historical sense, or the past alters the present. So past directs the present, just as the present alters the past. Just now we explained all this. I need not further go on complicating things. So, as a result of this, what happens to the poet? His creativity, the process, there's an artistic process. First is, there is a restriction. Or disciplining, I must say. There is, the artist is disciplined. Cannot do, there is a frame. See, tradition is like a frame, like this. So, the poet here, now he can act, but within this frame. Outside he cannot go. If he goes, no, you can go, but your uniqueness or your special type of individuality, etc. Now you can see, take this essay itself. In the criticism, in the order of criticism, existing order of criticism, tradition and individual talent altered the existing order of criticism. That's very interesting. No? This very essay has altered the existing order of criticism. Or you can say this very essay has changed the past. And this essay now becomes part of the past, with the result that there is a change, there is a readjustment of the existing order of criticism. This is very, very clear. So tradition we have explained, now we are coming to individual talent. Individual talent means a poet's talent. Anybody who writes, the writer. And it's very well said, no? No poet has his complete meaning alone. Here it is. No poet has his complete meaning alone. Why? Because he is bound by tradition. He is bound by historical sense. Or he is restricted by historical sense. Or he is restricted by the timeless and the temporal. Or he is restricted by all the literature of the world from Homer to the present. Now he has used the mind of Europe, and a lot of criticism has come up against T.S. Eliot saying that he is Eurocentric. In the mind of Europe here means not Europe, but the entire world, you can say. The literature of the entire world, not just Europe. Europe has just given an example, that's all. So mind of the world, he could say. Because he is, as you can see in this his own poem, he has taken references not only from English or European languages, but Sanskrit, that is Indian languages, isn't it? Sanskrit, as one of the Europeans, Europeans themselves said, that it is the language of the gods. Sanskrit is the language of the gods. So it ends with Shanti, 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 Datta, Dayathava, Demyata. So you can see that the poet is restricted by tradition. Understand that. Individual talent is, first is, the impact of this tradition is, impact of writing under historical sense is, that the poet is restricted. That's a little disciplined, you can say. Restriction maybe has a negative meaning, but you can say the poet is disciplined. That is better. See? Then second, what is his relationship with his own work? So, if you say, suppose this is the individual talent. 50% of that is tradition already. Tradition. Individual talent, 50% is tradition. Now, what about the other 50%? other 50% we can say emotion, personality, personality of the other, personality of the other, then materials, materials may be simple or difficult or whatever it is, and then synthesis, synthesis, and power of concentration, power of, immense power of concentration, immense power of concentration, that's it. So half of it is tradition, because your launching pad is tradition, your springboard is tradition, your platform is tradition. I think now it is clear to you what is tradition mean. A writer's platform is tradition. It is, as I told you yesterday, it is the umbilical cord that connects a writer to the historical sense, tradition. Okay, that is clear. Or you can say, as I told you, platform, springboard, or you can say what is called the place where you stand, your location. A writer's location, you can say. These are words that you can use instead of tradition. So 50% you can say, maybe I'm exaggerating a little, you can disagree with me, but just to make things clear, I'm saying 50% of tradition. What about the other 50%? You have got emotion, you have your personality, you have your materials, you have got a synthesis, you have got a power of concentration. And it has to be complex, not any simple. Yesterday I gave you an example, no, of train, a poem, the subject matter is train, train goes, train comes, there is accident. So this is no complexity. Understand? So certain elements, all these elements together. And then there is a complexity is created, as in the wasteland. In the complexity, there is a synthesis, a process of synthesizing. And this synthesizing takes place, what you call, under immense concentration of the other. With the result that what happens is, you produce a new emotion. And that new emotion is art emotion, emotion of art. So there, what happens is, the person, the writer's emotion disappears. And instead what happens, because of this artistic process, this complex artistic process, in the smithy of the other, the mind of the other is the smithy, is mother, other, under immense concentration, synthesizing take place. As a result of that, the product is your art, and this art has its own emotion, not the emotion of the poets. Then what happens is, naturally, the art becomes impersonal. This is the meaning when you say that artist surrenders. There's a two-way surrender. One surrender is, he surrenders himself to tradition, or he sacrifices his personality in front of, on the altar of tradition. Or you can say, with this sacrifice and surrendering, the other becomes extinct. He doesn't exist. When? At the point when you produce this work of art. Because the other is nowhere seen. Why? Because it is so complex a process. So complex. Now, Eliot himself says about the platinum, the sulfur and oxygen, and then a new product is created. It has nothing to do with the platinum. I would like to give you an example. Don't laugh at me when I give this example. You may say that, this is silly example. No, just look at this. You are making a vegetable stew. Imagine, you are making a vegetable stew. Now, what do you want? A vessel. And you want an agent. An agent is the cook. You have a vessel, you have got an agent, that is the cook. And inside this vessel, what are you doing? Putting all kinds of cut vegetables, cut in small pieces, big pieces, etc. Then there is immense quantity, energy is required. That energy is fire, okay? Your gas or whatever it is, electricity. And under this, what you do is, there is a synthesizing takes place in the vessel. Now, compare after that you produce this vegetable stew, which is mixed very well. You cannot recognize the pieces. You cannot identify whether it is lady's finger, whether it is tomato, whether it is carrot. None of the, you cannot add tomato. You cannot or potato. You cannot identify any of this. So this becomes a stew, and it is the process product. What is the process? Synthesizing. You cannot take the stew and say, this is lady's finger, piece of lady's finger. This is piece of carrot. You cannot say, because the synthesizing has already taken place. You have got him. And then can you say that the cook's emotion is the stew's emotion or the taste? The cook's taste is the stew's taste? You cannot say. See, he is nowhere near, but he is an agent. I think this example will very well make clear things to you. So here what vessel, that is the mind of the poet or the smithy. The mind of the poet is the smithy or this vessel. And into this vessel, what do? You put pieces of vegetables. That is materials that you collect from that. Your little bit of your personality may be, little bit of your emotion may be there. Then all the other, like a taxi throbbing, see? And then what else? All kinds of things that you think of. Taxi throbbing, the stars in the sea, or you can think about Sweeney coming to Mrs. Potter, washing their feet in soda water, and then you can think about what is your Tristan and Isolde, you can Hyacinth girl, you can think about Madame Sosostris, you have got that is Unreal World, Unreal City, you have got crowd flowing over London Bridge, you have got the man you know, you saw, and you saw a man who you know knew in the battle of Mille, that you can see the cruelest month, April. So all kinds of things you can see, we can put. And then the new process in an immense concentrated process that requires immense concentration. These complex materials, not simple materials, complex materials are synthesized, and then the work of art is produced. So when I compare the work of art to vegetables too, and the mind of the poet to a vessel, and the role of the poet as an agent, and the emotions of the agent and the vegetables too, sometimes you may laugh at me, but I think I am trying to make things clear to you and simple. So here the emotion is totally different. Now you want to know, just compare two poems. One by Wordsworth, Daffodils. Now what happens there? He sees the daffodils and his mind is energized and he is very happy, and some emotion comes into his mind. After some day, this emotion is recollected in tranquility, and he says that whenever I am in a pensive mood, whenever I am sad, I think of this. So very simple, no? One-to-one correspondence. There is a one-to-one correspondence. I see the daffodil. Daffodils create some emotion in me, and then later on I recollect it, and I enjoy that their sight. But think of Robert Frost's poem, Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening. In this poem, the first line and the last line, you will see there what is like a what is called a flowers in a bouquet or a garland, flowers in a garland. You are just connected like this. There is no synthesizing takes place. Flowers in a garland, they are separate. Flowers in a garland, it's there separate. But look at this Robert Frost poem, Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening. The first line is, whose woods these are, I think I know. What about the last line? Miles to go before I sleep. And in between, variety of elements. Some of them you may think is what relevance it has got. See the horse there shaking and all those things. What is the relevance of these things, you may think. But then what happens is, there's no relationship practically when you look at it as such. Woods are this and miles to go before I. So the artistic emotion created by this, by putting together these materials and making the whole, the complexity, resulting in a complexity, and this complexity is synthesized under the immense concentration of the poet, then what happens is, it becomes, the poem produces another emotion separated from Robert Frost. Without knowing the name of Robert Frost, without knowing the name of knowing anything about his biography, you read Stopping by Woods on a snowy evening, you enjoy that. You need not bother who has written this. But your understanding of Daffodils requires some understanding of Wordsworth's personal life. This is the difference between a complexity of materials synthesized under immense concentration, another already wasteland I told you, and a very simple poem like Daffodils. So in Daffodils, it is expression of personality and expression of the poet's emotion. If you say Daffodils is a turning loose of emotion, Daffodils is an expression of emotion. But what about Stopping in the Woods on a snowy evening, or a poem by Donne? It's not the poem. You need not bother whether who is this author. The work of art is there with you, and then you read it. The art or the work of art or the poem produces or some movements in your heart or in your brain. It is intellectual process, you can say. You understand, the other is emotional process. It is in this context you should understand. Poetry is not a turning loose of emotion, but a escape from emotion, your personal emotion. But in Daffodils, the poet doesn't escape, he expresses. But in Stopping by Woods, he escapes from the emotion, and then there is art emotion. But the process, the artistic process creates an emotion. Yesterday I gave you another example of hen and egg. No? So here, what I am coming to is his second relationship. I said this essay is about just one word I told you, you can sum up relationship. The first is the poet's relationship to the other poems by other writers. You can call it Mind of Europe, you can Pastness of the Past, you can call it what other things are existing order, you can call it Homer to the Present, you can Timeless and the Temporary, or anything you can call it. But this is the thing. That is, other poems or other paintings or other dramas or other short stories, any area you can explain by taking this one's relationship. Understand? Everywhere you have, because you simply can't escape from tradition. You are born, then you are part of tradition. You start writing, you are part of tradition. You have a culture, you are part of that tradition. But you can create new things. As Raymond Williams, when he speaks about culture, he says, you are born into something and creating new. Same thing happens here also. You are born into a tradition. Then the second aspect of culture is you create something new. Then that becomes culture. See that the past and the present coming together. And in this case, as I have been discussing, so what is impersonality? This is impersonality. Not that he is dying. When you say that, he surrenders. The poet surrenders, the poet sacrifices, the poet suffers. You may think that when you say suffer, is it like Jesus Christ suffering? No, nothing of that sort. See, you are suffering in the sense that you are withdrawing your personality from the work of art. You have to withdraw because 50% is tradition. It is not yours. This individual talent, when you say it is not 100% yours, it is only 50%. And then, other 50% you can say, emotions, your personality, your feelings, all these things come in, materials and synthesis, maybe a tap, a water tap, or it can be a cock, or it can be sitting on a roof tree and kokoriko, kokoriko. If it's a kokoriko, kokoriko, is it a poem? It is a poetry? No. But when it comes into this situation, it assumes the role of a great poetry. So that is the power of the artist. Anything can become great poem, provided it is complex, there is complexity, and it is synthesized under immense concentration. Anything you can. Look at all these great poems and the dramas and the short stories and any art form, or a painting, for example, painting or sculpturing, anything you can see. With the immense concentration of the artist, and the materials becomes complex, and there is a synthesizing process. Naturally, it will happen. I told you the example of a vegetable stew. Please forgive me for giving this example to you, for just making things clear to you. Yes. So here again, we are speaking about the individual talent. There is impersonality, or individual talent here means that you can say like this. It is speaking about the limit. Individual talent has a limit. Individual talent, you cannot use without any discipline. Individual talent is disciplined by tradition or historical sense, or other poems by other writers. Poem means all the other works of art, okay? So that is it, tradition. Then you have got all these things, no? You have got the taxi, you have got the cox, you have got the hyacinth girl, you have got everything. But and constant, then under heavy, or you can say this immense concentration, any element can be made a great part of great poetry. That is the thing, understand? So that is, therefore what happens in such a thing, such a product, the agent or the poet, he remains a silent agent. So that is what T.S. Eliot says, but tomorrow I am going to speak against this. That's another thing. This is what, now I am explaining his theory, therefore I am supporting him in this sense. But tomorrow I am going to tell you something else. I'll say that this is something that goes beyond all our rational thinking. That tomorrow, not today, today I am explaining this. So you understand what is impersonality. So here, theory of impersonality says that and therefore there comes approach to criticism. Therefore, honest criticism and sensitive appreciations are directed not upon the poet, because the poet's role is agent. The cook's role in vegetable stew, producing the vegetable stew, is an agent. So that there is practically no relationship between the final product and the agent. That is impersonality. Understand? So it says, honest criticism and sensitive appreciations are directed not upon the poet, because the poet is only an agent. According to him, I am going to speak against this. Okay. So this today, because I am explaining this essay, and but upon the poetry. Why? If this theory is accepted, you say, you find there is sense in this theory, it's a natural conclusion. The conclusion is that, what is after all artist? He's an agent. Why do you worry about him? Consider stopping by woods. I'm just giving that example, stopping by woods on a snow evening. You need not go on speaking about biography, where how many times he got married, how many children he had, what are the emotional stress that he underwent, how old he was when he died, and what is his zodiac sign. None of these things. You don't bother about it. Why? Because the product is here. And this product you have to criticize. Understand? Any art, work of art, produces an emotion. And that emotion, how that emotion impacts you, depending on that, you decide whether this work is great or not. And also, the parameters, three parameters: one, immense concentration, complexity, and synthesizing process. If these are there, the work of art becomes a great work of art, and it will become part of the existing order. Then the existing order changes, tradition changes, and then the next tradition will be existing order plus the new entrant. And that becomes a tradition. After some, another great work comes in, then that is admitted in the existing order. Existing order changes, and the second stage will be, that also will be included in this tradition, and thus goes again infinite. Infinite. Understand? You go. I hope you understand, but I was trying to tell you. If you don't, kindly contact me. I told you, Professor Thomas Matthew at gmail.com. So this is my second and the last lecture on tradition and the individual talent. As I already told you, this essay has changed the existing order of criticism. And then this essay has become part of the existing order of criticism. So the new tradition is created. See, so this, it will go on ad infinitum. Ad infinitum means without any end. Ad infinitum is a Latin phrase meaning there is no end. So tradition will go on. That is dynamic tradition. That is what I said. Tradition is not old-fashioned. We cannot. And if you want to acquire this tradition, it requires great labor. Very simple. No? If you want to acquire this tradition, a sense of tradition, it requires great labor, great thinking, great meditation, great learning. All these things should go together. Then you become a great author. That is what T.S. Eliot says. Whenever I say this is the opinion of the T.S. Eliot, not my opinion. By saying this, I am going to criticize T.S. Eliot. I am not posing as a greater critic than T.S. Eliot. I am not at all a critic, but I am a simple teacher and explaining these things to you. That's all. But I have my opinion that I will express tomorrow. And so here, impersonality, I think it is clear. So once again, summing up, I would say, tradition and the individual talent. Tradition means all the poems written by all the authors from beginning to the present. Individual talent means the poet's role in creating a great work of art. And this poet's role is restricted or disciplined by tradition. That is 50% of it, launching pad, the platform. See that. Against the platform in which he stands, the poet stands, that is given by tradition, and all these elements under they become what is called they are synthesized, they become complex, and under immense concentration a work of art is created. In that case, work of art has its own emotion, not the poet's emotion. So the poet withdraws. Poet has to withdraw. That's the thing. He himself probably might have never dreamt of this, but he has to withdraw because his personal emotion is maybe what I must say 0.1% or something. The other thing is the emotion of the art. Understand? Artistic emotion. Artistic emotion is created by an artistic process which is complex. Artistic emotion is created by an artistic process which is complex of materials taken from this, of course, world, any material, not a particular material, any material synthesized under immense concentration. Then that work of art and the author, the emotion of the author is no importance for the work of art or in the work of art. Therefore we say poetry is impersonal. Always remember Daffodils and the stooping by woods on a snowy evening. Then you can see that's a comparison you can make. See that. So in one this is a personality of the author, but in the other it's not like that. You can like even if it is written by, let's say, if you don't know anything about T.S. Eliot, you are reading and studying Wasteland. The Wasteland produces an emotion in you, artistic emotion in you. Understand? Because of the complexity of material, the complexity of the process, the synthesizing, the immense concentration of the artist, and also his moorings, you can say, connected, how he is related to the tradition, all these things makes a big, great work of art, a magnum opus, the great work of art. So that is why, you know, how many, there is an industry where Eliot criticism, which is called Eliot criticism. There's an industry, so to say. Why? Because people are trying to find out what is in it. What is it? Death wish? Is it the matrimonial misery of the author? There's no. No, no. You cannot. You simply cannot hold it in your mind. You know, that process, etc. It is so immense, so great, so complex, so. What I must say that mixing memory and desire, see, that is synthesizing all this, created a great work of art, and so, but the launching pad is, as you can see, tradition. Therefore, we say, the poets, therefore we say, art is impersonal. Two reasons. One, your launching pad is tradition. Two, you have got all the other elements. But together, what happens is, you produce an art emotion. Your work of art produces art emotion. And this art emotion has nothing to do or different from the emotion of the agents. The agent role is played by the author. So, art is impersonal. There is impersonality of art. So both theories, one is tradition, that is simply put, it is other poems by other writers up to and including the present. And then other relationship is, in the second relationship is, that is the poet's relationship to his own work. And there is, he cannot claim his emotion is different from, totally different from the art emotion produced by the work of art. Actually, I gave you another silly example of the egg and the hen. The hen produces the egg. But without knowing the name of the hen, without knowing the pedigree of the hen, without knowing whether the hen's name is Pertilot, Chanticleer's wife, no, Pertilot, you can enjoy the egg. See, that is, that's a silly example, but then that tells you that the presence before you, the separation of the author from the art, work of art. And that is impersonality. Not that he dies. Say, not that he dies or he becomes extinct. He there, his personality is there. But his personality is, in a way, you know, you can consider it like that. In the artistic process, when the artistic process ends, the personal emotion has no role. The personality of the author has no role. That way also we can say. Therefore, art is impersonal. When the process is completed, like the egg and hen, or like the vegetable stew and the cook, or like an atom bomb and the scientist. The scientist makes the atom bomb, but atom bomb is not scientist. And the scientist cannot say, do anything with the atom bomb, because it has got its own nature. If you drop it, it will create a lot of harm to the world, isn't it? It can destroy the world. But suppose the scientist says, I created you, you should not explode without my permission. nothing will happen. See that? So he is helpless. He becomes extinct. He has surrendered. Personality, and then it becomes impersonal. I think I have made both the points clear. What is so? Once again, summing up, I will say the whole essay, tradition and the individual talent, can be summed up in just one word, and that is relationship. Whose relationship? The poet's relationship. To what? One relationship to tradition, and the other relationship is to his own work. What is tradition? All the poems written by all the authors up to and including the present. Our pastness of the past, mind of Europe, anything you can call it. And what is this? Here, when the artistic process is over, you are thrown out. Nothing, the work of art doesn't throw you out, you have no role. That's the thing. Like the vegetables too. You have no role after that. It's like the egg and the hen. See? Like the bomb and the scientist. You have no role there. You have to withdraw. You have to become extinct. You have to sacrifice. You have to surrender. Then what happens? The work becomes a great work. And then, as a result of this, this great work will alter the past. At the same time, remember, this great work was directed by the past. See? Therefore, what happens? Honest criticism and sensitive appreciation are directed not upon the poet, because poet is nowhere there, but upon this, upon his poetry. So all these things are collected, and therefore poetry is not a turning loose of emotion, but an escape from emotion. And therefore poetry is not an expression of emotion, but an personality, but an escape from personality. It's not that you purposefully or with great difficulty escape. No, you have to. The situation you yourself have created. The great work of art. You are nowhere there. Because you have got how many points, remember, in the great work of art? Tradition, the elements, some of them as irrelevant, unrelated, incongruent, or even sometimes you say preposterous. So some elements are like that. So then what happens? Synthesizing. These elements put together as a complexity. This complexity is synthesized. Synthesized under the immense concentration. A work of art is produced. Then that becomes great. And this great work alters the past. And this great work and the agents, that is the poet's, the emotions are different. And therefore, the great work of art is impersonal. And therefore, honest criticism and sensitive appreciation are directed not upon the poet, because he is only an agent, not upon the poet, but upon the poet. I think I have somehow managed to make you understand what is tradition and what is also impersonality, the theory of impersonality. And my next lecture, the third one, will be a critic of this idea. So, wait for that. Till then, have a nice time. Good day. I wish you all best of luck in your studies, especially when you are reading T.S. Eliot's this great essay, that is Traditional Individual Talent. I hope that my explanation would be of some help to you. With this optimistic note, for the time being, bye-bye. Have a nice time.